We began with CEDAW, or the Convention for the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, the actual document, and the 30 articles. We now turn our attention to the CEDAW OP, or the CEDAW Optional Protocol. The Optional Protocol amplifies the authority of the committee by formalizing grievance communication structures and procedures for adjudicating cases. This increases the frequency of communication on specific articles. The United Nations General Assembly adopted the CEDAW Optional Protocol on October 8, 1999. The OP was entered into force on December 22, 2000, per the provisions in Article 16. Whereas nearly every United Nations member state was by then a state party to CEDAW, a little over half, or 104 nation states, 54%, became parties to the CEDAW OP within the first decade. 81 CEDAW state parties, or 46%, did not become parties to the CEDAW OP. You can see the ratification patterns on the maps from the United Nations. Those parties in dark blue are state parties to CEDAW. Likewise, for the optional protocol, the parties or the states in dark blue are parties to the OP, whereas those nation states in orange are not state parties. The CEDAW OP enhances the influence of CEDAW in three ways. First, the optional protocol amplifies the power and authority of the CEDAW committee by granting authority to hear and adjudicate individual and group grievances. OP state parties in signing commit to the possibility of external monitoring of their conduct concerning provisions of CEDAW. Wade Cole, in his early study of human rights covenants, noted with respect to the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the optional protocol provides the most rigorous monitoring provisions available. CEDAW state parties, likewise, in signing the optional protocol, formally, in quotes, recognize the competence of the CEDAW committee to receive and consider communications by or on behalf of individuals or groups of individuals under the jurisdiction of a state party. By offering individuals a venue for filing grievances outside the state, the OP provides for this plausible instance of international monitoring. In Cole's words, relinquishing a part of their sovereignty. Second, by granting this enhanced power to the CEDAW committee, the OP parties enact what Laurie Nathan, with reference to constitutions and comprehensive peace agreements, calls a more credible commitment, a more credible commitment to adhere to the principles embodied in CEDAW. OP ratification may constitute an act less substantial than a constitutional amendment or credible commitments, as understood in peace studies. However, it nonetheless demonstrates a serious and convincing show of allegiance to the convention and its goal of eliminating discrimination against women. Zwingle similarly notes the added weight of OP ratification, including the OP signing as one of her three components of principled connectivity. Thirdly, the optional protocol heightens the frequency and sharpens the focus of peaceful strategic communications between the CEDAW committee and state parties, however modestly due to time and budgetary constraints. The CEDAW committee has reviewed 139 cases since 1999. These formal communications add up to the 564 reporting documents and constructive dialogues based on the country reports submitted by CEDAW parties every 4 years over the 15 years between 1999 and 2014. Zwingle, again, identifies reporting habits and dialogue frequency as two components of substantive connectivity. Reporting habits include both the number of reports and their timeliness. Time lags provide also an important metric of commitment. Finally, the heightened bar of the CEDAW optional protocol produces variance, whereas nearly every nation state is a party to CEDAW. As we saw earlier, fewer states, 54%, are parties to the optional protocol. Wade Call did not include the optional protocol as a critical predictor variable in his 2013 analysis of CEDAW, which is surprising given the significance of his findings on optional protocols in his two earlier studies of different UN conventions. Our earlier and more preliminary work, based on his work, that is, the work with Stephanie Perez in 2017, used the CEDAW OP with significant results. Our findings in that paper corroborated the relationship Cole observed between the percentage of women in Parliament and CEDAW in a time lag analysis. My newer research, to which many of you are invited to join, is presented here and concerns largely the CEDAW OP and the Gender Inequality Index over time, although I have also used other measures of women's equality as these change in relationship to nation states becoming a party to the CEDAW OP. First, members with higher levels of value rational alignment, that is, internal commitments to gender equality, will be more likely to be state parties to CEDAW and to the CEDAW OP. The independent variable is OP party, and the dependent variable is gender inequality, or the Gender Inequality Index using the United Nations data. Gender inequality will change over time in an inverse relationship to the increasing number of parties by year. State parties, and again, this is, we're anticipating or looking forward to material that comes ahead. State parties that enter reservations upon signing CEDAW are less likely to become parties to the CEDAW OP. As you can see in the graph on this slide, the value rational alignment between the Gender Inequality Index and the CEDAW optional protocol, the heightened participation in democratic processes it provides, and the proliferation of educational materials brought about by the convention and the increased communication are evident in the results. The data analyses replicate and expand earlier research. Figure 1 here shows gender inequality by year and corroborates the value rational alignment, or what Zwingli calls substantive connectivity. CEDAW OP parties begin with and then perpetuate statistically significant lower levels of gender inequality or lower GII scores. The effects of focused communication are revealed in the slightly higher rates of change over time for state parties. Those of you who might like to put that finding under a microscope with me should next semester in a different course, a more focused course or research course, should contact me. The last slide is a reminder as we move forward, or as you move forward, to begin collecting data for your blog 1 and for your final paper. The academic integrity issues are slightly different in the online environment. Actually, they're not different. They're amplified largely because of the likelihood that you'll be using digital images. Don't forget to cite digital versions of images or digital images in a slightly different way than you cite text. On this course site, you'll find the Yale University Library guide for citing images. So thank you, and I look forward to working with you in the coming weeks as we hone in and focus on factors that explain differences in level of commitment to CEDAW.